trip to the moon, and she won't be back too soon. She doesn't write me and I can't sleep. All I hear from her is, my baby's up in a rocket machine. Since she left, she ain't been seen. She doesn't call me and I can't sleep. All I hear from her is, I wonder if means I miss you, or maybe means I want to kiss you. I'm hoping that means I love you, and she's coming.
So welcome to Astronauty Week. This is some special programming by the Colin McEnroe Show. Every day this week, we will look at some aspect of our relationship to the idea of extraterrestrial life. I'll tell you in just a second what's going to happen today. But on Tuesday, we will be talking to Adam Frank and Neil deGrasse Tyson, both astronomers, astrophysicists, just sort of about the nature of outer space and what could conceivably be out there, what could be learned from things like the James Webb Space Telescope. Wednesday is sort of a more, I guess, sort of an ethnographic look at the idea of encountering strange beings with Donna Pasulka, who's been with us before. We'll also be talking to a Yale scholar who looks at ways in which depictions of strange events dating back to the Middle Ages seem to include some of the things that seem kind of ET to us. And Thursday, we are lifting our ban on astronauts, our six-year ban on astronauts, and Chris Hadfield will join us. And I think what we're going to do is also replay the interviews with Buzz Aldrin and Scott Kelly that led to our ban on astronauts. And then lastly, on Friday, but certainly not leastly, Jamie Green has written a really fascinating book about how – it's partly anyway about how culture tries to interpret the science that relates to extraterrestrials and extraterrestrial life. We'll also be talking towards the end to somebody who's been with us before, the great actor Doug Jones, who's played an awful lot of non-human creatures, when we'll talk to him about what that's like, how to sort of figure out how to be something other than a human being. All right. But we're very excited to begin the week. It's the perfect thing to begin the week with somebody who's been with us before, Garrett Graff, journalist and historian. His latest book, we should say that his previous book, Watergate, A New History, which is an indispensable way of looking at Watergate. He was here with us for that. Garrett's back. His new book is UFO, The Inside Story of the U.S. Government's Search for Alien Life Here and Out There. Garrett Graff, welcome back to the show.
Thanks so much for having me to kick off such a big week.
Yes, it's very, very big. We're so excited. So, you know, I think when we think about, first of all, we should say this is a really fascinating history of sort of how the government has tried to understand or failed to try to understand reports of UFOs and what's kind of happened as this sort of auxiliary or voluntary groups of citizens, sometimes assisted by scientists, have tried to weigh in or maybe fill in what they see as gaps in the government's understanding and so much more. But, you know, as I was trying to think about it comprehensively, I was thinking that for a long time, there were sort of two extreme theories about this. One of them was the government knew all kinds of stuff it wasn't telling us, maybe even was in treaty negotiations with extraterrestrial governments or had dead alien bodies, and that's actually sort of back in the news recently. That was sort of the one thing. And then the other one was the government didn't take UFOs even remotely seriously. All the people – I was a newspaper reporter in the 70s, and, you know, people were talking about Project Blue Book and stuff. They were sort of – they tended to be discounted by most people, saying the government is interested in extraterrestrials. The government has much better things to do or much bigger things to do. Well, although what really could be bigger? So, Garrett, talk about, I mean, what you find is kind of the middle here, which is the government is kind of perforce interested in UFOs, but maybe not that good, maybe not that good at investigating them.
Yeah. So I got interested in this subject in, you know, my background, as you said in the intro, is as a national security writer. And I had noticed this shift in the way that people in Washington talked about this subject in the last decade, particularly after a series of reporting by Politico and the New York Times in 2017 about a series of Pentagon projects focused on UFOs and what the government really now calls UAPs, unidentified anomalous phenomenon. And that those programs coming out of the shadows, as along with some reports from Navy pilots, Navy aviators about encounters with objects in the skies that they couldn't explain, with technology, possessing technology and appearing to move in ways that the U.S., they believe, did not have the capability to counter, changed the way that the, you know, highest levels of national security circles in Washington talked about this subject. And you began to hear serious people talking seriously about this. And as I got into paying attention to that conversation, there was one conversation, one interview, one quote that really stuck out for me, which was the former CIA director John Brennan in December 2020 gave a quote, gave an interview where he says, basically, there are things out there that we don't know what they are. It puzzles us, and it may constitute, the phenomenon may constitute something that may be a new form of life, or may appear to be a new form of life to us. And that comment really stuck out to me because I figured, you know, John Brennan at that point had wrapped up the better part of a decade as the CIA director and the White House Homeland Security advisor for President Obama, and that there couldn't be that many things left that puzzled John Brennan. You know, when he woke up in the morning and had a question, surely there were, you know, tens of thousands of analysts and intelligence officers and sensor networks and signals intelligence systems and satellites that would go out and try to answer the questions that he had. And as you sort of laid out, I think the challenge is when you dive back into this history, as I did for this book project, and go back across basically the 80 years of the government's interest in UFOs, which dates back to the end of World War II, what you see is the government, you know, both covering some things up, but not necessarily the sort of giant grand Men in Black conspiracy that you hear in Hollywood and pop culture and conspiracy circles sometimes, but also being sort of generally just as puzzled as anyone else about what UFOs and UAPs really turn out to be.
Yeah, so, you know, this is it's an amazing book, and it's a sprawling book. It's, as you say, 70 or 80 years of this history. It's more than 400 pages plus very elaborate footnotes. I was trying to think of a way here in the first segment that we could kind of nutshell the story a little bit, and I came up with this idea. There's one person, I think, who spans an awful lot of these years in an awful lot of different capacities. He's kind of the Zelig of your book. He just keeps popping up again and again. I happen to have met him once, actually, at a UFO conference. His name is J. Allen Hynek, and he's a scientist. And, you know, Garrett, in terms of, you know, if the beginning of your story is 1947, 1948— Hynek walks in there kind of in Act One, and he's still around for a lot of the subsequent acts. So maybe just introduce us to Hynek in the context in which he is first enlisted as a non-UFO believer in looking at one of these reports.
Yeah, the modern UFO age really begins in the summer of 1947 with a series of sightings that begins with an Idaho businessman named Kenneth Arnold, who sees, he's a pilot, he's flying near Mount Rainier in the Pacific Northwest, in the Cascade Mountains, and he sees what he later describes as nine objects, saucer-like objects, moving at tremendous speed. The media picks up his reports, kicks off this national fascination that summer, and he ends up, you know, the sort of flying saucer age begins with, you know, sightings that summer across 34 different states, including what we now know as the infamous Roswell crash, although that summer it was just sort of part of the background of noise of all of these sightings across the country. And that wave of sightings happens at a really interesting and important moment for the U.S. government, which is that it is just beginning to orient itself for the Cold War. That summer, the Congress passes what's known as the National Security Act of 1947, creates the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the modern Defense Department, the Secretary of Defense position, the National Security Council at the White House, the Central Intelligence Agency as the nation's first peacetime intelligence agency, and creates the Air Force as a standalone service branch of the military. Because up until then, of course, the Air Force had been part of the Army. And the Air Force is really their first crisis as a service is the flying saucer and the wonder of what it could be. And at that point, almost no one thinks or believes or suspects that these are extraterrestrials. What the military is concerned about and why the Air Force gets involved, the FBI gets involved that summer, is that they are afraid that these are secret Soviet spacecraft being built by kidnapped Nazi rocket scientists. Because what was the US's big threat right then? It was the dawn of the space race, the dawn of the rocket age, the dawn of the missile age. And we were building our own rockets and missiles, based on the Nazi V2 rocket with Nazi rocket scientists that we had brought over from Germany and put into places like Los Alamos and the White Sands Proving Grounds in New Mexico. And so they were afraid basically that the Soviets were ahead of us on that technological development and were racing to uncover what these flying saucers actually were. And so the Air Force launches this series of programs. You've already mentioned one of them. It starts off as Project Sign, eventually becomes Project Grudge, then evolves into something called Project Blue Book that runs for about 20 years.
And this guy Hynek, just to go back to him, he's involved in all of those, although he's initially just sitting there minding his own business at whatever university he's at or whatever he's doing.
Yes.
And somebody says, could you come over here and look at this thing? Although I've actually now forgotten which one of the things it was that he was first asked to go look at.
Yes, and he's brought into Project Sign and Project Grudge almost right at the start. Not because he is any sort of genius of astronomy, but as he jokes, that he was the closest astronomer to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, where these projects were originally getting off the ground, the center of sort of Air Force technical intelligence in the 1940s. And so he was an Ohio State astronomer, is pulled into this to basically help them understand what chunk of these UFO sightings are actually just normal astronomical phenomenon that people are getting confused about.
And I mean, just we're just going to do like a speed date through Hynek, because I think it gives a sense of the scope of your book as well. I mean, after some time with this, he kind of transitions out of that and more into these citizen-driven groups. Probably MUFON is the one he becomes best known for, but he kind of makes a change and he's a little bit more. I mean, there's this huge alphabet soup of all these different groups, ad hoc groups, groups that kind of constitute themselves to look at these questions. And he's trying to, I feel like a lot of the time, Hynek is trying to keep a foot in both worlds, take the claims seriously enough so that he's not being dismissive, but also not coming across as credulous so he can turn and face his peers, at least some of his peers. And so, but say a little bit more about that little tightrope act he has to do.
He spends the next quarter century of his career really increasingly focused on this. You know, he goes out and covers many high-profile UFO sightings on behalf of the government, on behalf of the Air Force, and becomes, in many ways, the public face of, you know, the real scientific study of UFOs. Eventually, the U.S. government just loses interest in UFOs entirely in the late 1960s, early 1970s. But by that point, he's become convinced that there is something to this. Not necessarily aliens, not necessarily extraterrestrials, but there's something to UFO sightings. And so he goes off on his own and founds what's still operating today as the Center for UFO Studies, and becomes associated with these other things, other sort of UFO groups that like MUFON that you mentioned in the 1970s, writes really the definitive book on you know, the scientific approach to UFOs and coins the whole nomenclature that we now use of close encounters of the first kind, second kind, and third kind, of which Steven Spielberg's movie eventually is based on. And J. Allen Hynek actually ends up with a bit part in the Spielberg movie.
I told you, he's Zelig.
Based on his book.
He's Zelig. He's everywhere. He actually gets like $500 a day to be a consultant on Close Encounters. And he gets a little cameo. So I just wanted to have you tell two other Hynek stories, or at least one other Hynek story. And that would be, just to give you a sense of, if they ever made a movie about Hynek, it would be a pretty interesting movie. Like, at one point, he goes to Papua New Guinea to investigate something I think a priest has seen. Just give us a little sense of that story.
Yeah. So one of the things that he most struggles with in his search over, you know, 25 years are the credible witnesses who come forward who have some experience that is not easily explainable by known phenomena. And there's sort of two categories of these types of witnesses. One are, there's a 1964 sighting by a Socorro, New Mexico policeman named Lonnie Zamora, who stumbles across something in the desert while he's out on patrol that takes off and flies into the sky. And that Lonnie Zamora, there are other witnesses and some physical evidence that back up that sighting that make clear that sort of something happened to Lonnie Zamora that day. And J. Allen Hynek goes out and meets with him and just sort of can't figure out, like, you know, this is a small town cop who has every reason to not report encountering a UFO. You know, a lot of potential credibility to lose and nothing obviously to gain. And then he goes to Papua New Guinea to investigate a sighting there that's sort of famous in the ufology community, as it's known, named by a missionary named Father Gill, who sees a craft hovering in the sky near the village where he's working, sees a figure come out on the craft. You know, craft balcony, if you will, that waves to them, and that he, you know, really makes a study of these truly puzzling sightings over the years. And it is that sort of those types of encounters and witnesses and sightings that really move J. Allen Hynek from the sort of arch skeptic that he starts as in the 1940s, when the Air Force sort of first shows up to knock on his office door in Ohio State, and moves him along to be the person who sort of is most associated publicly with the search for UFOs and you know, what we now call the extraterrestrial hypothesis. You know, the possibility that the cause of UFOs is extraterrestrials.
And Garrett, that particular stance or that particular drift by Hynek also gets him into this, it's almost kind of hilarious. It's like a rap beef that he has with Carl Sagan. Just give us a little sense of the Sagan-Hynek feud, which really kind of took me by surprise.
Yeah, so J. Allen Hynek and Carl Sagan really represent the two halves of this book, where I try to weave together both the story of the U.S. government's search for UFOs here, as well as the evolving science and astronomy around the search for extraterrestrial intelligence out across the rest of the universe. And J. Allen Hynek, you know, becomes the figure most associated with the UFO half in the second half of the 20th century in the United States. And at the same time, Carl Sagan really becomes the most publicly known figure associated with the search for extraterrestrial intelligence across the wider universe. You know, Sagan becomes this incredibly famous astronomer. His PBS series Cosmos in the 1980s is probably one that a lot of your listeners remember as a, you know, signal moment in television in the 1980s. And that he, Sagan and Hynek sort of, you know, TV show after TV show, radio after radio, conference after conference, become the sort of two arguing voices about, you know, are UFOs aliens? You know, do aliens exist at all? Are they coming to visit? And part of what's interesting about this is that they are both really sort of strong believers in the possibility of extraterrestrial life. And in fact, Carl Sagan's argument over the years evolves into, it's not that he believes that aliens don't visit Earth. It's actually quite the opposite. He argues that there is not only life, but intelligent life out there across the universe, and that it probably swings by Earth every 100,000 or 200,000 years. And so his argument, Sagan's argument, it ends up not being aliens aren't visiting Earth. It's that the particular sighting that, you know, you experienced last Tuesday out your bedroom window is unlikely to be the one day of the last 100 or 200,000 years when aliens popped by Earth.
So we're going to go to a break here. I just want to quickly say that one reason I asked about Hynek is I think sort of in the early 80s, I was just as a newspaper reporter asked to go cover a MUFON conference, I think in Boston. And he was very much, you know, the kind of centerpiece of the whole thing and was sort of presiding over it. And there was a former claimed abductee. Her name was Betty Andreasen, or Betty Andreasen Luca. And she was one of two people named Betty in kind of roughly the same time period in New England who claimed to have been abducted. But she showed up and uninvited had brought this kind of sculpture or statue she had made of one of her alien captors. And some of the people from the conference said that Hynek was just so upset. It was like his last thing he wanted was this goofy looking statue showing up at his conference, which he was trying to keep, you know, at a respectable level of skepticism. So I think it was an unenviable tightrope act that he had to do. And you certainly sketch it out very well. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back. We're going to maybe talk about two presidents who saw UFOs and maybe a way in which the UFO conspiracy theory boom has led to a lot of the other, what we now call our epistemic crisis, which is that nobody believes facts anymore. All right, we'll take a break. We'll come back. My flying saucer, I pray this night you will sail back before the day gets bright. You will sail back before the day gets
bright. Saucer flew down to Earth one day. Looked to left and right of it, couldn't stand the sight of it, and said, "Let's fly away." They took a look at a
western. So we're back with Garrett Graff, journalist and historian. His latest book is UFO, The Inside Story of the U.S. Government's Search for Alien Life Here and Out There. There's a way, I think, Garrett, that you have been covering other aspects of government and policy for a really long time, and this is a much more natural segue than people might have guessed. Let's just talk about, for a moment, two consecutive presidents who claimed to have seen, well, they did see UFOs, because we have to acknowledge that a UFO is an unidentified flying object or a UAP or whatever we're going to call it. So let's start with Jimmy Carter. Jimmy, and where else are you going to see a UFO? Right outside the Lions Club, I guess in Georgia somewhere. So tell us about Carter and his UFO and kind of how that, we'll also talk a little bit about how he tried to turn that into presidential policy.
Yeah, one of the funny things as you get into this is it turns out, you know, much like that Us Weekly segment on celebrities are just like us, it turns out presidents are much like us, and that basically every president since Harry Truman, when that modern age of flying saucers starts, one of the first questions that they have when they get to the Oval Office is, are aliens real? And, you know, do we have any captured spacecraft? And you particularly see this come to the fore in the 1970s, where you have three U.S. presidents in a row who actually all took UFOs pretty seriously. Gerald Ford, when he was a congressman, actually represented a district in Michigan that had a series of high-profile UFO sightings to our last segment, J. Allen Hynek ends up getting dispatched to that J. Allen Hynek, much to his personal chagrin, because he doesn't believe the theory himself, is told to report that the Michigan sightings are nothing more than swamp gas. And that doesn't satisfy Gerald Ford, who calls for what end up being the first congressional hearings on UFOs in the late 1960s. And then Jimmy Carter.
Before you go to Carter, can I just interject? Because yeah. There's a great quote from Ford in your book that's sort of like, it's kind of what we want everybody to say, and everybody does say it, and then it doesn't get done. He says, apropos of everything you just said, we owe it to the people to establish credibility regarding UFOs and to produce the greatest possible enlightenment on this subject. Are we to assume that everyone who says he has seen UFOs is an unreliable witness? I think, you know, that's a great quote from Jerry, and it's sort of the attitude. I mean, that attitude kind of permeates your book, too.
Yes, and that really, you see that actually in the Jimmy Carter sighting. Jimmy Carter, as governor of Georgia, sees in the sky outside of a Lions Club one night what he thinks is a UFO, and in a way that, you know, is actually very consistent with, you know, the person that we come to know as Jimmy Carter, dutifully reports it through sort of the official, you know, national UFO reporting network.
There's like a form he has to fill out. He answers all the questions on the form.
That he details his sighting and where he was and what the object looked like and what time of night it was. And then he, you know, sort of talks publicly about this. You know, he's not afraid to talk publicly about this experience. And it actually, interestingly enough, it takes decades for people to piece together what he actually saw.
What he saw was a
secret military test, actually, that had, you know, sort of hit the lower atmosphere and created this big cloud that he sort of thought was a UFO.
And Garrett, I think that's a point worth pausing over. So Carter's sighting is going to be sometime in the 70s. It's 2016 by the time they sort of piece together their knowledge of this barium enema or whatever it was that was up in the sky and Carter's report. And I mean, that's an indication of just how long it takes to sort of, you know, line up all the dominoes about something like this. But it also probably explains why people often don't believe the official explanation, that it took you from 1970 something till 2016 to come up with this story that you're telling us now. You can maybe understand why the rank and file goes, really? Because I don't know. Like, well, how come you didn't know that right away?
Yeah, and this gets to one of the hardest challenges of basically this entire 80-year phenomenon, which is the government is just really bad at knowing what the government knows. And what I mean by that is, it's just, you know, the government's just really big. There are a lot of different secret projects going on at any given time across a lot of different agencies and military branches, and that you often end up seeing that the U.S. military's own secret projects end up causing public UFO reports, and that it's not even always clear to the government that it's other parts of the government causing these UFO reports. And this, in fact, leads to some tragic incidents. There's a famous incident in 1948 where a Kentucky Air National Guard pilot and a couple of his colleagues are dispatched to chase a UFO that's reported over Louisville, and that they end up only this one pilot, Captain Thomas Mantel, ends up spotting the UFO. He gives chase. He sends back this series of ambiguous reports on the radio. I'm still climbing. It's enormous. It's metallic. It's above me. And then he goes silent. And it takes about an hour before they get the airbase gets reports that his plane has actually crashed. And this this causes this real panic inside the government for a moment of, is this UFO actually hostile? Did a UFO actually shoot down a U.S. fighter and kill Thomas Mantel? And what it takes is that's in 1948, again, sort of at the dawn of this flying saucer age. And it takes until 1952 for Project Blue Book and, again, J. Allen Hynek to piece together that actually Thomas Mantel was chasing a Navy research balloon that was being developed by, of all people, the cereal manufacturer General Mills. And that basically, like, Thomas Mantel, crack fighter pilot and World War II veteran, did not know that the thing that he was chasing was a Navy project. And so, again, it was a legitimate UFO to him. It was something that he had never seen before, that was 300 feet across, flying across the skies of Kentucky. That's exactly the type of thing that he should be trying to engage with and track.
Yeah, and certainly, we certainly learned our lesson. It's not like, decades later, we're going to be launching a quarter of a billion dollar missile at some rando balloon up there, right? That's never going to happen again.
Exactly. And that's what you sort of end up with, seeing again this winter, is that, turns out there's a bunch of stuff up there that we don't really know about on a regular basis, that we don't really pay any attention to. And that, if you turn the NORAD radar slightly differently, as they did in the wake of the Chinese spy balloon in February, you end up finding all of these other things out there that we end up trying to panic and shoot down with advanced fighter jets and quarter billion dollar missiles. And, what we got was a hobbyist balloon from the Northern Illinois Balloon Brigade Meteorology Club.
Right. We shot down the Cheerios balloon, and then we shot down your balloon. We're not going to put up with balloons over an 80-year period. All right. So we're coming towards a break, but I think we need to get started on this next thing, because to me it's maybe the most important thing for me in this book is the story of the way that conspiracy theories develop, partly just because of the inadequacy sometimes of government's responses, and the way that it kind of leads to our current crisis. And there's a direct line from a guy in your book named Bill Cooper and a somewhat notorious radio personality from Austin, Texas. So maybe sketch that one out for us, Garrett.
Yeah. As you mentioned, my last book was on Watergate. And one of the things that was most surprising to me diving into this subject was realizing that in many ways, the second half of this book is a sequel to a book on Watergate. What the second half of the story of UFOs and the U.S. government in the second half of the 20th century is the story of the collapse of truth and trust in government institutions in the wake of Watergate and Vietnam and the Pentagon Papers and the Church Committee and the Pike Committee. You see the rise in the 1970s of this new breed of conspiracy thinking, this dark, new, ominous belief in what the government is capable of. And it manifests itself in the first instances among UFOs, and this idea that the government is not only covering up its knowledge of UFOs, but actually, crashed alien spacecraft, dead alien bodies, perhaps even in the darkest forms of this, that the U.S. government has entered into peace treaties with alien civilizations that allow for the abduction of American citizens by these alien civilizations. And these become a really big part of the ufology movement in the 70s and 80s, and particularly around the question of Roswell, which is this sighting in an encounter and sort of mistaken incident in the summer of 1947 that's quickly forgotten then, but is brought back to the fore in the 1970s and 80s as the, you know, time when these craft crashed in the New Mexico desert. The U.S. government recovered them, recovered bodies, and has hidden them away from the American public for 50 years. One of the main founders of this UFO conspiracy movement is this guy Bill Cooper, who is claims to be a naval intelligence officer in Vietnam who saw the documents laying out this grand conspiracy and the conversations with the aliens and crashed craft and bodies and all of that. And as the 1980s goes on, Bill Cooper drifts from UFO conspiracies into, you know, the early era of conservative talk radio, and becomes one of the leading voices of conservative talk radio in the 1990s with his iconic national talk radio show that he does from his bunker compound in Arizona. And he becomes the inspiration and mentor in many ways to a Austin, Texas talk radio host named Alex Jones. And that the two of them end up really in this, you know, small stakes feud in the late 1990s over, you know, truth and conspiracy and government and blah, 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 blah. And that they have a real falling out after 9/11, where Alex Jones begins to embrace what we now know as 9/11 trutherism. And Bill Cooper thinks that that has basically a bridge too far, and that Alex Jones is now lying to his listeners in a way that Bill Cooper believes that he has never actually lied to his listeners about UFOs. And then actually Bill Cooper, you know, by this point has drifted into the far right fringe, you know, tax protester movement and things like that, and ends up dying in December 2001 in a shootout with police who have come to arrest him. Bill Cooper opens fire on them, shooting a deputy. The police return fire and kill him. And at that point, though, sort of the idea and the conspiracy movement that Bill Cooper has helped found has jumped into national political discourse, and I think in a very direct way that many people don't understand. I think that there's actually a pretty straight line mm-hmm. from these UFO conspiracy movements in the 1980s through to January 6th, that really the first place that we see the deep state emerge in the political spectrum and political discourse is among UFOs.
You know, we're coming up on another break here. Reading that, I was thinking about your point there and also this whole week. And even though I was a huge fan of it at the time, I actually think that the X-Files should shoulder a little bit of the blame here, because one of the fundamental arguments of the X-Files was, as the seasons went on, it's all one big conspiracy. And they would like tie the cigarette smoking man into the JFK assassination. And the whole argument was sort of the Alex Jones, Bill Cooper argument. You can't trust them about anything. And the most fundamental thing they're lying about is something almost along the lines of a treaty with space aliens to give them bodies, or it was also a little hard to sort of figure out what the baseline conspiracy was. But there was that kind of blurring that went on in the show, and a lot of people watched that show.
Exactly. And that becomes a huge part of the 1990s and the way that all of this, you know, weaves together in popular culture, and that, you know, you see these ideas of what the government is capable of really spread across, you know, from sort of the fringes of talk radio land, the fringes of conspiracy land, right into, you know, sort of the bloodstream of American politics.
Right. And that's going to set us up perfectly for our final segment here with Garrett Graff. We'll take a really quick break and we'll come back.
Well, here come the Martians. Well, they're picking up a Martian pie. I hope the Martians like me and give some to I. Well, here come the Martians. Well, they're setting up a Kool-Aid stand. Well, where's their financial advisor? Somebody should take him by the head. The Martian rhyme, rhyme, rhyme. Martian time, time, time. You got a Martian rhyme for Martian, a Martian time. And the Martians have notebooks in their little hand. They're still strangers in this land. Martian rhyme, it's Martian, a Martian time.
Technical producer today is Kat Pastor, senior producer of the Colin McEnroe Show, Lily Tyson. She is also kind of the queen, the interstellar queen of Astronauty Week, and the producer of this particular episode as well, with Garrett Graff, whose new book is UFO, the Inside Story of the U.S. Government's Search for Alien Life Here and Out There. One quick thing I want to say about the book that I salute you for is that, I mean, you obviously stick to the facts, but there's also, I think, very little kind of laughing up your sleeve, very little of kind of these credulous idiots when you're writing about people who saw and believed these things. I mean, these are all just very human being, very normal. They're human, and they're seeing things, and they're trying to get them explained. And I salute you for not, you know, kind of sneering at them.
Well, thank you. And I think part of the reason for that is if you look at this phenomenon, there is something here that we don't know what it is.
Yeah.
You know, there are UFOs, as you mentioned. You know, there are unidentified anomalous phenomenon that we do not yet understand. And I think that the government should take it more seriously than it does. And that's part of what the modern, you know, resurgence of interest in this subject, I think, heartens me. Because you see across decades a very consistent subset of sightings and encounters that are truly unexplainable by known science. And that is not me saying that I believe that these are aliens visiting Earth. I think that, you know, part of what gets confused in this is that you can believe in UFOs and believe in UAPs and still think it's not aliens. Right. And that to me, you know, I think that UFOs and UAPs, you know, end up being, you know, a couple of different categories. You know, some chunk of it is adversary technology being tested against us, you know, Chinese, Russian, Iranian drones, for instance. Some chunk of it is things like that, what we saw in that Chinese spy balloon flap, you know, you know, weird sky junk that we're not really paying attention to.
And for a long time, some of it was our tech too. I mean, it was tech that we didn't want anybody to know about.
Yep.
Yeah, there is that little margin which we can't entirely explain. I do want to just quickly say that I did laugh once during the book at somebody's expense, and it was this guy named Bethurum who sort of founded a UFO cult, and it was around this hundreds of years old gorgeous woman from outer space, apparently named Aura Raines. And when his wife eventually divorced him, she cited this hundreds of year old beautiful alien Aura Raines as a correspondent, and the cause of the marriage is unraveling. So that's got to be a record. Not that many people get divorced because of their affair with an extraterrestrial. But we only have like about 6 minutes left. And I do want to just have you talk a little bit about 2017 and afterwards. Obviously, there is a sea change here in the public debate. A lot of it does revolve around Leslie Caine's and Ralph Blumenthal's reporting in the New York Times. And this whole subject just gets on a different footing, Garrett. And I'd love to know a little bit about how you see that.
Yeah, I think what we are living through right now is a, you know, probably the most serious you know, discussion about understanding UFOs and UAPs that we have seen since the 1940s or early 1950s, and that the U.S. government is under a tremendous amount of pressure from Congress to take this subject more seriously and try to deliver better answers. And some of that is a national security question. You know, as I said, some chunk of this is adversary technology here on Earth that we don't yet understand, that the military, you know, should be more interested in trying to understand. And then I also believe that there, you know, there could be really important, world-changing, meaningful, insightful answers to science questions buried in better understanding UAPs as we're trying to study them now. You know, this is advancing atmospheric, meteorological and astronomical phenomenon that we don't yet understand, as well as the basic physics that we don't understand. You know, to me, we should be really humble about how little of the world around us we really understand right now. You know, I think we sort of think that we have mastered understanding the world when all indications are that we have a lot more to learn about it. You know, just this summer, for the first time, we observed gravitational waves moving through outer space that bend space-time. And I think that there could be you know, really mind-bending physics that we don't yet understand that will only really come with more scientific advancements. You know, Avi Loeb, the chair of the Harvard Astronomy Department, he points out that everything that we humans have learned about relativity and physics happened during the lifetime of the world's oldest woman, when she died in January this year. She was 118 years old, a French nun, and everything that we discovered about relativity and quantum physics was discovered in her lifetime. And we should be humble about what the next human lifespan, or 500 years or 1,000 years or 10,000 years, if our civilization lasts that long, might cause us to learn.
Right. Well, we just need to find one more French nun and make sure she has a good diet and gets a lot of exercise, and then she'll understand the rest of physics over the ensuing 118 years. The book is great. It's been so great to talk to you again, Garrett. The book is UFO, The Inside Story of the U.S. Government's Search for Alien Life Out Here, and Out There by Garrett Graff. And also, listen to the rest of our Naughty Week shows. We have an awful Astronauty Week shows. We have a whole bunch of really interesting guests here, and I hope you stay with us for the whole ride. Garrett, thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me. Good luck with the rest of the week.